Howdy, and welcome back to Thundercast, ThunderTech's regular podcast, delivering ideas, insight, and innovation to the middle market. I'm your host, Craig Israel, Creative Director here at ThunderTech. So today's pod is another in our series of podcasts highlighting articles from our Marketing Trends publication. 2019 marks our 10th year of creating our annual report on the emerging trends, techniques, and topics of interest to middle market businesses. You can get your own digital copy right now if you go to thundertech.com/trends2019. That's trends2019. So today we're talking about one of the articles in the publication, and it's about integration of your digital marketing and customer service efforts into your physical environment. We're going to talk about why it's important and, more to the point, why your customers expect it. To help break down this topic, in the studio I have with me Jason Therrien, president and founder of ThunderTech.
Howdy, Craig.
Hey, Jason. So welcome back.
Thank you. So
we're going to jump into an article that you authored for the Trends publication talking about bringing digital into the physical space. What really struck me when I read this was how, like a lot of marketing things, it starts in the B2C, starts in the retail space, but quickly like disseminates to the rest of the world. And more to the point, how, like you indicate in the article, it's not science fiction anymore. People are doing this. This happens every day and has been happening for years. Brands might not recognize how the extent of how it is already in the marketplace. But let's start at the beginning. Tell us a little bit about what you mean when you say taking the digital brand into the physical world.
Yeah, so you're dead on, Craig. This is not something new. I mean, many of our trends that we've published over now 10 years in this book, it's not always a shiny object, right? It's more important that we identify trends like this one that are gaining critical mass. And sometimes they sneak up on us and they just happen. And if you're not paying attention, you know, that's what you're talking about. So, you know, as you've said, between screens and then touch screens to then streaming media, obviously every consumer is carrying around a device in their pocket or their purse. Mm-hmm. So the digital world has absolutely become part of the physical world. The trend that we're seeing, though, is that this is becoming much more intentional, much more planned. The amount of interesting brethren in other creative spaces that we're working with, like architects, AV suppliers, interior designers, et cetera, that these spaces that are either being rebuilt or built from scratch are being thought through just much differently and how they can be interactive, how they can perhaps use content differently than in a static design type of environment that we've been used to.
Yeah, and sometimes we talk about trends or marketing techniques where the marketers or the brand are pushing it out to the customers, but this is definitely a case where consumers are expecting this and in many cases demanding it.
Right. That, you know, why, if I can go online and pick out the finishes of my car, why can't I actually go into the dealership and do the same thing mm-hmm. on perhaps a much larger screen, but to actually get a feel for, again, what I may be purchasing. Again, these things are popping up. It's just that they're coming at a much quicker clip now.
Right. So a couple of the things you identify in the article is, you know, one of the low-lying things is just having Wi-Fi in your space, right? That I've come to expect that in most places, and I'm willing to pony up my email address or my name in order to do it, but you know, when I walk into a business and it's a secure Wi-Fi that they won't share with me, then, I mean, immediately I have a negative experience,
yeah.
Right?
And we're saying, hey, this stuff is now table stakes.
Right.
You better have a guest Wi-Fi. You better have the ability to take payment freely other than just behind a register.
You know, and that particular example really struck me is how subtle some of this stuff can be. Just the experience of someone can walk up to me in a store and say, hey, can I help you? And help me right then and there at shelf, instead of saying, hey, follow me back to the register at a different part of the store. You know, really subtle, a minor interaction, but you know, it seems to make all the difference.
Well, and what digital has also been doing from a consumer behavior standpoint, it's training us to self-serve. So I was in Home Depot over the weekend, And there's now, within their app, they have everything mapped per store because, you know, there's different store footprints and different stores may have different things that they carry based on region-specific items. If you have that question, you can now ask the app where something's located versus going off and trying to find a stranger.
It's so funny that you mentioned that because I had it in my notes to call Home Depot out because this is an interaction I've had in store where I want a specific bolt or screw or flange or whatever, and I wander around for a while because I'm a typical male consumer. I don't want to ask an associate if I can find an associate.
Right.
Instead, I go to their website, search for it, and then their website and their app allows me to narrow it down by store, and it gives me the aisle and the bin that it's in.
Yeah.
So I can go directly there. And if I couldn't, I'd be wandering around for hours.
Or you might have walked out without that flange.
Right.
I can never find the right flange. Yeah, I think there's elements to this where in that example, Craig, it's how do you take friction out of your process,
right?
How do you move them to a quicker purchase? Yeah, but that's only one half of it. There's a lot of education, entertainment now. I mean, we all want to be entertained.
So I wanted to ask about that in particular, because in the article you call out how these physical environments need to be robust, effective, and entertaining. How important do you think it is for most of these experiences to be entertaining, right? Are consumers demanding not just the information they want, but they want to enjoy the consumption of it?
So that's a good word, the enjoyment. I think entertainment, when we talk about it, it can be confused with like a leisure activity. Mm-hmm. And that's not where ThunderTech, I think, is coming from with this trend. It's more about give me something that is appealing to me, that I find interesting and intriguing. Frankly, for the brand's perspective, something that pulls me closer into that brand because they are giving it to me in a way that is, again, just interesting. It's more ideal than a static or non-existent form of entertainment.
Mm-hmm. So you call out some example environments where we're already seeing the digital being pulled into the real world. So some of them are pretty intuitive. Sales centers, retail, welcome areas, event spaces, innovation centers, other points of sale. And, it started me thinking about last time I went to the doctor, I checked in via kiosk right there. Instead of waiting in line, going up to that window, having to shout at the old lady behind the counter and waiting there while she brought up my chart, I walked right up. I typed in a few things, and then they said you're ready. Sit down, you'll be called. And in some cases, you can pay your copay right there.
Yeah.
And again, this is something that strikes me is how remarkable these interactions aren't, right? That they become mundane. That we expect this sort of thing, and then we miss it when it's not there.
Yeah. So that's I'm glad you brought up a couple of those stories because I think the mundane. While it's not as sexy as a 10-foot video wall, it's frankly, it can be very efficient and it can, pull a customer closer to you. It can pull them to check out faster. It can do whatever that process is that you want to adhere to, but perhaps more efficient. So that's where we want to make sure the listeners don't mistake this for just giant touchscreens with video on them. There's so much more to this digital integration into physical spaces.
So you mentioned efficiency. And so I wanted to ask some points on that.
Mm-hmm.
So we see companies are always trying to balance between how to be efficiency and how to deliver great customer service. And one of the examples, a little far afield from what we're talking about that comes to mind, is your typical customer service phone interaction, right? You call in type one for this, type two. This is super efficient for the brand, for the company, because they don't have to employ, a human to answer these questions. And if a user can get through the whole phone tree and get their question answered just through the automated system, that's great for the brand. But for the user, we know that often these phone trees can be frustrating and there's a wait time. So how should brands approach the balancing between efficiency for their processes and just still delivering great customer experiences.
So that thinking is absolutely what is desired from our end, and I think needed from the customer's end, is that too often when we watch brands build in digital tools or pull digital tools into physical environments, they believe it's a substitute for a human or for a time-tested method that may still work. And it's not to say they can't supplant, you know, these types of offline behaviors or vehicles to serve somebody. They really need to augment them to say, all right, how far can digital a digital tool take you before you need a human? Is it the fact of the associate coming up to you, asking if you need help, and they have the iPad with them with all the stock, all the availability, all the how-to videos all preloaded, so they're ready not just based on their education and training, but they're ready with the whole digital library to answer whatever possible question you can have. And that's a great example, I think, of a both digital and also kind of a physical, still using a human being, but using them to a higher purpose.
You know, it's to call out Home Depot again, as much as I appreciate them making it easier for me to find what I want through their app and through their website, what they don't have are touchscreens in stores, right? I would love to see at the end of every aisle just a big kiosk that says, what are you looking for? And I can have that same interaction instead of having to peck it out on my phone.
Right.
And to your point about humans, it seems like at least the Home Depot where I shop, every person is an expert in their section, but God forbid you ask them about something that's outside of their category because they are completely flummoxed.
You got it. And I think that's where we've also seen tools like that assist in the B2B landscape because, again, no matter what you're selling, whether it's your flanges or a crazy portfolio of petroleum products, you know, for the chemical industry, it's so hard to know everything. I mean, we don't have a single client that is paring down their offerings. Everyone just adds, right? Your inventory and SKUs get bigger, more complex. Your service sets get more integrated or complex. And it's just, it's difficult. And again, people don't have the attention span or frankly, the patience for you to go back and find an answer for them. Mm-hmm. So how do you give if there's a human interacting with the consumer, how do you arm them from the brand side with as much of that information up front?
Well, so that I think is an important part also called out in your article that consumers are demanding these experiences and they want them to be convenient and immediate, but also personalized, right? And this is a trend that we see touching just about every aspect of marketing today, that your consumer demands that you are giving them content, information, selection, suggestions that are specifically tailored to them.
Yeah. And there's actually 2 points you just made, Craig, that are covered elsewhere in our Volume 10 Trends book. And the one is around data and personalization. And as much concern as there is over privacy and data protection, as there should be, there's also this demand that you know me. I just bought from you yesterday, so why don't you know what I like and don't like?
Right. And, but don't keep any of my personal information and don't be creepy.
You got it. You got it. Let's have our cake and eat it too. And that's just the challenge that marketers have to face is that you better become, if you're not already, it's been a long time coming, you better become friends with IT because they're really the ones that are going to help you figure out your data controls. But on the other side, if you understand the data you have on your customer, really understand it and why a consumer would find something of value with personalization, you can deliver that much more of a richer experience. And then to your earlier point, those offline behaviors that are starting to affect online, I'm sorry, the online behaviors that are affecting the offline world, there was a report that we go through in our consumer trends portion of this book that Gen Z, so this is the group right after millennials, when they look for customer support, the number two method is actually by phone.
Yeah.
So I found that like really interesting. But then the kicker is they won't wait on hold for more than 45 seconds.
Right.
Because who isn't, you know, used to just instantaneous answers? Google has trained us very well for that. Any question you can ask is answered in a millisecond.
Right. So I think this transitions into another part of your article talking about, because I know it can sound overwhelming to brands, especially middle market brands who may be really embracing this notion of bringing the digital into the physical for the first time or just dipping their toe.
Yeah.
It seems overwhelming, but you make the point that brands may not be aware of all the stuff they already have done that can help with this.
Awesome point, Craig. That is absolutely the place to start. Every brand, B2B, B2C, government, doesn't matter. Everyone's building content these days, right? Textual content, visual content, video content, all of this. So you're building a library. Now, I hope it's in good shape and centralized or at least mapped where all this stuff is stored, but you have it at your disposal somewhere, hopefully.
Well, and things like GDPR are forcing brands
that's
to really, you know, look at their data and make sure that it is, you know, they have their ducks in a row.
Another awesome point.
And another article in the trends book.
This must be part of your job description, Craig. The one fun thing that I think we've allowed a lot of clients to dip their toe in this water is saying, what on your website, let's get really basic here, what on your website could be reused or repurposed in a physical environment? And for some clients, it's inventory or it's messaging. It might be video, et cetera. And we're saying, you don't have to go crazy with a 20 by 20 lobby screen. You can just take some really nice oversized either screens or touch screens, and we can rework the user experience, the UX, for a screen of that size, but pull the same content through. So you want to have a salesperson in your sales center talk to a customer and allow them to compare whatever your product might be. Well, cool. If you do that on your website already, why not bring it over into a bigger fashion that these folks can then just huddle around? And again, voila, you've already been bringing in digital into the physical world.
And this seems to touch on our favorite acronym, COPE.
Oh, I love it.
Create once, publish everywhere.
COPE.
So it's, you know, brands should embrace the notion that it's not just, you know, taking that video and putting it on your website and pushing it on social and using it face to face, but right. Holistically, your whole enterprise, looking at what you have at hand that you can use for different purposes.
Because all these are distribution methods. That's all this is. So that if you have a great video, it's not just living on the site and YouTube, but is it in your lobby? Right? One of the reasons why these AV companies are working with us is all around content. They're not in the content game. And, you know, a lot of them are brought in by the architects or building contractors that might be putting out a new, you know, lobby or new conference room or whatever. And then they flip the thing on and there's no content. I mean, we walked into a gigantic, I'd say they're at least Fortune 1000 firm, that had spent a ridiculous sum of money reworking their lobby, and it was running a skewed PowerPoint because nobody talked about what they were actually going to put on there.
Right.
It's like, it's ridiculous. You have content all over the place. Pick the right piece of content for the right environment, and again, you're already a step ahead.
And so the final point you make in your article is that brands don't have to do everything at once, that they can dip their toe in and start using some of the content they already have on hand just to get into the game.
That's totally true. It's like everything else we talk about on Thundercast is, you know, usually the first hurdle is just starting, but then how do you iterate, right? If you've already built something through your website or other tools, digital tools, you don't have to rework it from scratch. You change the interface a little bit. If you've already paid to have that video produced and it ran on TV or ran on your social channels and that was the end of it, why can't it run in your lobby? You know, I mean, it's not rocket science. So start there. then you can become more immersive. And that's where I think the science fiction everyone gets caught up in is, you know, when the lights change, when you enter the room and the right music comes on and the right imagery pops up because it's all personalized. Like, we'll get there. We will absolutely get there. But you don't have to start there.
Right. All right. I think that is going to wrap it up for Thundercast this week. Special thanks to Jason coming in, talking about this topic.
Thank you, Craig.
So if you like this podcast, you can subscribe to Thundercast on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever fine podcasts are sold. This pod was part of our 2019 Trends series, which you can download right now at thundertech.com/trends2019. That's Trends 2019. And if you're dying to hear more, including previous Trends topics, you can find our full library of 90-plus past episodes on our website at thundertech.com/podcast. Thundercast is a production of ThunderTech, an integrated agency for the connected world, serving clients in Cleveland, Detroit, Chicago, New York, around the nation, and across the world. Your host is me, Craig Israel. This episode was recorded, edited, and produced by Matt Stevens. Thundercast production coordinator is Shantae Rollins. Thanks for listening.